I scaled all the highest of mountains, and I stood at the edge of their peaks, but I still couldn't see to the edge of your love for me. And I walked on the wildest of waters, and I sunk to the depths of the sea, but I still couldn't fathom the depths of your love for me. Canyons wide, oceans deep, can't contain all your love for me. No matter how high or far I reach, there's no end to your love for me. And I wrestle belief in the valley, and I barely hung on through the night, but just when I thought it was dark, yeah, the sun began to rise. Canyons wide, oceans deep, can't contain all your love for me. No matter how high or far I reach, there's no end to your love for me.
Beyond the stars, to the very breath I breathe, there's no end to your love for me. Where could I run that you wouldn't run after me? How could I fall when you already took the fall for me? Beyond the stars, to the very breath I breathe, there's no end to your love.
Up towards the sky, eyes fixed on you. Your presence is where I hide. Above every fear I rise, eyes fixed on you. And you're never shall I feel you by my side? You were for me, who could stand against me? God, on you.
Come on, every voice, we sing this together.
So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. Oh, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Sing, Lord of all the earth.
And Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord.
At your name the mountains shake and crumble. Let your name, the oceans roar and tumble. Let your name, the nations will bow. The earth will rejoice and your people cry out. Come on, you say, oh Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, oh, we love to shout your name. The morning breaks in glory. At your name, creation sings your story. And at your name, the angels will bow, and the earth will rejoice, and your people cry. Oh Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name. Oh Lord of all the earth, we shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord. We sing, there is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. We will praise you, there's no one like our God. We will sing, there is no one like our God. Oh Lord of all the earth, we shout your name. Come on, everybody.
skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, oh, we love this show, your name, oh Lord. Yes, oh Lord. You sing Yahweh, oh, yes, oh Yahweh, Yahweh. Yes, we love this job, your name, oh Lord. You sing Lord of all. Shout your name, shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, yes, we love you, Lord of all the earth. Shout your name, filling up the skies with endless praise, endless praise. Yahweh, Yahweh, we love to shout your name, oh Lord. Amen. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. So, so kind to me. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Do you give yourself away? Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Yeah. When I was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so kind to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. And you have been so, so kind. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up. come on, believe it. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down. As a kid, I was bullied pretty bad as a kid, and I battled insecurity and a lot of issues in my childhood that I kept to myself. And I will tell you that the thought of taking my own life is something that's come more than once, but he never stops chasing you down. There's no wall he won't kick down. There's no lie he won't tear down. Coming after his children. Tonight is so important. It's so important. So would you sing this for those that you love? That the enemy would love to distort things tonight, to lie to them, to make them feel like they've been defeated,
when the King of Kings is standing with the victory in his hands and he says, no, I already paid for that and I'll keep coming after you because I love you. Sing it with me.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. And oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found and leaves the 99. And I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, but still you give yourself away. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. God, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you that even in the darkest moments of our lives, and there are moments, God, where we face some pretty dark things, God, you stay the same. Yesterday, today, forever, you are the same, and that means that the hope that lies within you stays the same. In every season, in every chapter, thank you, God, that you loved me enough to come after me. Thank you for the people that you've placed in my life that have pointed me toward you in my darkest moments. And for every person in this room, I think we can echo that prayer in so many different ways. The seasons, the moments, the days in our life where we felt so alone or so broken. And because of your faithfulness, God, we were able to climb out of that pit in your strength. Some of us are still trying to climb out. And I pray that tonight would be a night of redemption and deliverance, that chains would be broken in the name of Jesus, the name that makes the darkness tremble, the name that is above every other name, the name that is holy and worthy to be praised and honored and exalted. We look to you tonight. I pray for Pastor John that you would just fill him with your Holy Spirit, that he would speak words of truth and of power, and that they would convict and pierce our hearts tonight, and that they bring hope and life, because you are the one who will speak. Thank you, Jesus. We honor you in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Man, it is good to be together tonight. Amen? Yeah. Hey, I'd like to introduce the MC. Is that allowed? Am I stealing your job by introducing you?
This is part of the...
Hey, this is our radio host for Walking Truth Radio, Mike Massaro. Some of you know his voice. So yeah, Mike, take it away.
Thank you, Shane. Hello. Thank you, Shane. I'm digging the headband, by the way. It's very very Dire Straits. It's an 80 reference. My wife wants me to stop living in the 80s, but why? Why would I want to, you know? So you had to be there. Welcome to Living Truth Christian Fellowship, home of these 633 apologetic events that we do every so often, also home of the Walk in Truth radio show and podcast. Our mission or our goal is to bring the truth of the gospel to you guys in a way that's easy to understand, in a way that you can take those truths and then share them with your friends, your family, and ultimately an unsaved world. So thank you for being here tonight. As Shane said, my name's Mike Massaro. I kind of help out with the radio show. Tonight we have a topic. It's a heavy topic. It's thinking biblically about suicide. And while it's a heavy topic, it's unfortunately a timely topic, as it is always. But even more so, if you've seen any of the recent news or some of the polls, especially with young people, that It's really becoming an issue in our society today. So hopefully Pastor John can come up and you know, maybe kind of open the word and see where we can go in Scripture to that. So before I introduce Pastor Michael to then introduce our guest tonight, I want to do a little housekeeping, or as Pastor Michael would say, house cleaning. Questions. One of the cool things about 633 is we're able to have you guys ask questions to our speaker, but we're not going to run out to you with a microphone and make you stand up in front of everyone and you know, ask your question in front of everyone here. We're going to do it very discreetly and very, you know, it's anonymous. But the way you do that is you go and you download the Living Truth Christian Fellowship app if you don't have it already. I know a lot of you already do, but if you don't, you can get it from your app store, Living Truth Christian Fellowship. It's the one with the little red circle with the pillars. So go ahead and download that, open it, and down at the bottom there is a little cross icon. You would just tap that, and then you'll jump right out at you that says ask questions for 633. So anytime during the talk tonight, or even anytime once we've already started answering questions, if he says something or Pastor Michael says something that sparks a question in you and you're like, oh, maybe it's too late. No, just go ahead and put that question in, and through the magic of technology, it'll end up here on stage. So that's how you get your questions in. Finally, everyone's other favorite topic is restrooms. When you gotta go, you gotta go, but you gotta go to the restroom to do it. So go out this back door, and then to the left, there's one single bathroom there, so you can try that one. If it's occupied, like it is every time I try to get in, you can, you know, do an about face, come around this side hallway all the way back here through the gumdrop cavern into the back hallway where the restrooms are, men's and women's. Guys, you gotta walk all the way down, so sorry. Okay, so that is restrooms, and I think that's just about everything. So I'm going to ask the pastor of Living Truth Christian Fellowship, Pastor Michael Lance, to come up and introduce our guest. So thank you.
Good evening. Hey, everybody. Good to see you. Hey, I want to welcome our live stream audience tonight. Wherever you may be watching, we do have several people who have moved out of state but are a part of our church family. They join us pretty much every time we do a service, and it's really cool to have just a church family all over the country and sometimes even in other countries that join us via live stream. So we are grateful for the technology, and a big thank you to our tech team back there that makes it all happen. Thank you, guys. And thank you again, Pastor Shane, wherever you went. Pastor Shane, for your faithfulness in leading us in worship. Before Pastor John comes up, I am Pastor Michael Lance, and it is good to have you here tonight. I think I know just about most of you who have joined us, but if you are new, we want to welcome you. And we do these, we originally planned on doing these quarterly, but it's been a little bit more than quarterly. There's so many topics to deal with. And so we kind of break from our normal expository teaching on these evenings, and we get into a topic, and we try to look at that topic from an apologetic point of view. 1 Peter 3:15 says, "Sanctify the Lord in your heart. Always be ready to give a defense, a reason for the hope that you have, but do it with gentleness and respect." And so there's a lot of hurting people in our world, and there's a lot of very difficult topics out there that we have to deal with, and we want to take them head on, and we want to deal with them with clarity and compassion. That's really our goal, is to bring truth, but to bring the truth in love. And one of my favorite verses I just want to share with you is about prayer. It's about our great high priest. It says, Hebrews 4:15 and 16 says, "We do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin," speaking of Jesus. "Therefore, in light of this, let us approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." If you find yourself in a time of need tonight, you're not alone. That's one of the main things I think we want to say, is that you're not alone. There's a lot of people who struggle with difficult feelings and depression and anxiety and even suicidal thoughts. And if that's you, you are not alone. We are here to minister hope to you. We are not here to beat anybody up. And I tell you, I just got to know Pastor John just a little bit, and I watched his presentation, and he has a wonderful accent, first of all. Love it. And you'll hear it in a moment. And he has a pastor's heart. In fact, he is a pastor. And I think that's part of the beauty of how God has called you, Pastor John, is that I know you didn't pick this topic necessarily, but it came to you, but your pastor's heart comes through. And it's really a beautiful thing because I think it's the shepherd's heart coming through as you speak to people. So we are glad you are here. We are glad you are here with your bride tonight. And you have four girls, right? How old are they now?
10 to 3.
10 down to 3 years of age. So you need a lot of prayer.
Lots of prayer.
Especially your wife. Okay. Well, that's awesome. So Pastor John is a speaker with Stand to Reason, which is an apologetics ministry here in Southern California. Great ministry. So everybody, that's... Welcome, Pastor Jon Noyes. And as Pastor is getting into the pulpit, let's pray for him. Father, thank you for Pastor Jon and his family. Thank you for him having such a great pastor's heart. Thank you for him answering the call on a difficult topic. May you minister through him, anoint him, bless him, and thank you for him. And I pray tonight would be just a wonderful night of ministry in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you for that introduction. I am here. I got to make sure I get my timer out because I am a preacher. Some of you apparently know what that means. That means I've never spoken for under 2 hours, and it always ends in an altar call. So, no, I am a privileged man. A husband of a beautiful wife, a father of four young girls, able to travel the country now, speaking on really difficult topics. This being one of them, for many of us tonight, this is actually going to be, if you get my slides up, this is going to be one of probably the more important topics that you guys hear about. It has nothing to do with me. It has absolutely nothing to do with this slick presentation that we just popped up on the screen. But it has everything to do with maybe where you find yourself this evening, or where a friend or a loved one of yours finds themselves this evening. It's something that perhaps you guys are facing right now. You know, I like to think about this as we begin our journey into thinking biblically about suicide. I like to think of the great hymn writer, John Newton. Do you guys know who John Newton was?
Yes.
I got to feel your love up here, friends. Do you guys know who John Newton was?
Yes.
Yeah, right? He wrote that amazing hymn, Amazing Grace. It's filled with words that resound with hope. The Lord hath promised good to me. His word my hope secures, his will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. These are sweet, they're encouraging words. I even now reading them, I've read these words to audiences just like yourselves a dozen times, and my hair still stands up on my arms. They affect you. They resound in something otherworldly within you. They're somehow more than just words. But a name that you may not know is William Cowper. You know, some of you in this room may know him as a famous hymnist. But what most don't understand or know is that he was John Newton's best friend. And he wrote these words. Encompassed with 1,000 dangers, weary, faint, trembling, with 1,000 terrors, I, in a fleshly tomb, am buried above ground. This is a man who struggled through life with thoughts of depression, suicide, and he was lucky they had such a good friend in John Newton. Because as William Cowper was plagued by these things, these thoughts, John Newton, on many occasions, was able to talk with him and pray with him and reassure him of the promises of God. And he saved his life more than just once. William Cowper, he had a friend, and that friend made all the difference in the world. I want to be really clear as we start our talk. There are some of you right now watching online. There are some of you right now in this auditorium who love Jesus. And you're struggling like William Cowper. There are some of you right now who are watching online or in this audience who know somebody who loves Jesus. But they're struggling with thoughts of suicide. There's some of us in this audience, my third group, maybe you're online watching, or maybe you're here right now tonight and you know nothing of Jesus. Maybe you find yourself very far and heavy laden, burdened by a life gone awry, not according to your plan, and you're struggling with this. The point of me saying all of this and the point of me bringing this up is the fact that you are not alone, as your pastor said this evening. You are not alone. And if that's the only thing that you bring away from our discussion this evening, you need to understand there are people around you who understand exactly what you're going through. Whatever group of those three I just mentioned you represent, whatever one you find yourself in, this talk this evening is meant for you. My goal tonight is to give you guys some very practical tools to have a very difficult conversation with some people that you might love more than anything in this world. I'm going to do this mainly by addressing three points. Why? Because I'm a pastor at heart, and what would a talk be without three points starting with the same letter? Took me longer to come up with these than anything else in the talk. We're going to start with why is this important, and then we're going to talk about why do people contemplate suicide, and then we're going to talk about what can we do. You'll notice it's two whys followed by a what, and as I get going, I want you to know I am a preacher at heart, so I get going, and I hope I don't get going too fast, but I'm also from New England, if you haven't noticed, and we talk real fast. So I'll try to stay calm and slow down because this, in my opinion, church, in my opinion, this is one of the most important topics any of us can discuss. It's at the center of our culture right now. Why do I say this? Because of the data. Statistics don't lie. They tell us the truth. We live at a time right now, in the last 20 years, suicide rates have risen by more than 30%. It's the number two leading cause of death for those aged 10 to 34. The current statistic, before COVID-19, the statistic was that 12% of college students were going to contemplate committing suicide. When I say contemplate suicide, that means coming up with a detailed plan when, where, and how. More than 800,000 people every year die by suicide. These numbers are staggering, and they're only increasing. I've read so many reports as COVID-19 has hit our nation. You read from reports from major hospitals. Within the first 3 months of COVID, emergency rooms received more visits in just those 3 months for suicide-related incidents than they did all last year. A study by the CDC, which was released just 4 or 5 weeks ago now, they surveyed 5,000 college-age students. And you know what they found? They found that 25% of those surveyed contemplated suicide in the first month of this pandemic. I need us to wrap our minds around that, friends. 25% of those aged 18 to 24 contemplated suicide within the first month of this pandemic. You know, more than 110 people take their lives every single day. That's four every hour. That means by the time I get off of this stage, at least one, if you're lucky, just one person will have taken their own life. Why is this important? Well, it's important to understand that this is more common than any of us would think. And this is part of the secret that we need to let out of the bottle here. You are not alone. If these are your thoughts, if you wrestle with this, you're not alone. Statistics don't lie. The statistics tell us that you are most likely sitting in a room with people who understand exactly where you are. It's what we do with that that matters. You might feel like you're alone, but you're not. Don't believe that lie. For me, my first call as a pastor 6 or 7 years ago was from a distraught mom and dad. This is my first call. I've been a pastor for 7 weeks, coming from a law firm. Mom and dad called our emergency line at our church. Our adult son has locked himself in our bedroom with his gun, and he's threatening to kill himself. What do we do? Things got heavy real fast. Luckily, through prayer and a lot of help, actually their son now heads up a rehab facility in downtown LA, has a happy ending, but they don't always. This is Derek. He's my cousin. Derek, Derek died by suicide on January 23rd, 2011. He shot himself in his head with his wife and son in the next room. While I was doing my main research for this this project, that the culmination you're seeing here before you, you'll see Stephen there. Stephen was one of my first roommates as I moved to California. He was amazing, a good friend, beautiful wife, 4-year-old boy. He committed suicide last June. You see, this issue wasn't one that I've ever planned on speaking on, but how can I not? Because this issue touches us all, every single one of us. It's touched me in a very real way, as you see on the screen behind you, and there's so many more I could put up there, and it's touched you, I think, in a very similar way if we think about it. And let me also be clear at the onset of our conversation, friends. I don't come here today as anything special. I don't come as a trained apologist or theologian. I don't come to you even as a pastor or an expert in really anything. I just come to you as a man who's been affected by suicide in his own life. Lots of people have been affected by this issue. We just don't ever talk about it. And if we think about that fact, it's very similar to abortion. You know, for the longest time, abortion was relegated to the dark corners of our churches even. Don't talk about that. Certainly the dark corners of our culture, but we saw what happened as we started bringing the conversation to the culture, as we started talking about the issue, the light was shed on those dark corners and lives were saved. And I think the same thing can happen with suicide. It's this dark issue that we've pushed to the corners of our places that we like to go, and we don't want to talk about it, but we need to open that box. We need to let the light of the gospel shine on this issue, and lives will be saved. You see, why is this important? We need to let these kinds of issues break our hearts. And as they break our hearts, we need to move towards them with the truth of who we are, according to the true story of reality. We have to allow the compassion of that and the love of the gospel lead us towards other people as we pursue the answer that I think everybody, to the question that everybody is asking themselves right now. Why do people contemplate suicide? You know, you see a bunch of reasons up there, but one main reason. It's interesting, in the literature, when you're doing your research on suicide, you hear a lot of reasons, but then at the conclusion, there isn't one. We don't really know. I think we do. You know, some of the reasons could be that there's a closing in of circumstances on one's life, and they just can't take it anymore. And sometimes it's financial, sometimes it's relational. You'll see them up there, substance use and abuse. They often play into it as well. Other reasons, they're anger, jealousy, depression, self-pity, pride, shame, guilt, revenge, escape from pain, loneliness, isolation, rejection, loss of status or power, autonomy. The list goes on and on. And on, but ultimately the answer to this question, why do people contemplate suicide, finds its beginning in a lie that every single person believes that does die by suicide, and that is that they're better off dead than they are alive. And that is a lie from the pit of hell. It's a lie. Why do they believe that, though? Well, because they lose hope in this life. They survey the circumstances that they find themselves and they can't find a way out. You know, the answer as we seek it, why do people lose hope? It varies also according to worldview. And this is where I like the traffic, right? Christian apologist guy. Worldview is important. Christians and non-Christians both. We all struggle with loss of hope, but for different reasons, I think. So I'd like to look at both of these reasons here for the non-believer and the believer alike. And we're going to start with the non-Christian, if that's okay. Is that okay, guys? Do you guys love me? Oh, okay. Because I'll tell you what, I'm sweating up here. And I just started. I think the first thing that comes to everybody's mind when we start talking about suicide, what do you guys think it is? Somebody commits suicide. What do you got? Where's your mind go? Mental health. Right? Mental health. That's where my mind went. There must have been a mental illness. And that fact is in. But the statistics, we got to go back to the data, friends. The statistics don't lie. 54% of those who die by suicide have not been previously diagnosed with a mental illness. And then at the same time, as we see that statistic there, and we see the statistics of suicide rise, we have never had a better understanding of how the brain works than we ever have. You know, in the last 20 plus years, we've seen amazing strides in medical advances. We're able to treat anxiety, depression, schizophrenia, multiple personality disorder better than at any other time in history. We know more about how your inside head works than ever before. Then why are we seeing dramatic increases in suicide? Do you see what I'm saying? Do you see what I'm saying? Because we would think as a clinical capacity to deal with this topic increases, we should see suicides decrease, and that's just not what we're seeing. In the course of my study and reading the literature, I find this. It's just so clear. It's become so clear that as the Judeo-Christian influences wax and wane in our culture, mainly wane, we see suicide rates skyrocket. You see, there's been a shift of ideas, friends, and ideas have consequences. So let me talk about naturalism a little bit. Or I'll have a question. Naturalism is this idea that all that exists is the physical realm. And everything is merely a result of a physical or naturalistic process. You know, one famous naturalist and atheist, he says the nitrogen in our DNA, the calcium in our teeth, the iron in our blood, the carbon in our apple pies were made in the interiors of collapsing stars. He He says we're made of star stuff. That's star stuff, if you're taking notes. You see, our naturalism, we're simply just a random quantification of molecules dancing to our DNA. We're meat suits in motion. And this matters because our worldview, it influences how we answer life's biggest questions. You know, questions of meaning, questions of purpose, questions of origins and destiny, questions of morality, questions of identity. Who are you? And on this view, naturalism, it's hard to see. It's hard for me to see, even now, my mind is racing. It's hard for me to see how anything at all can have meaning, including us. If we're just random molecules bouncing into each other, meat suits in motion, how are we valuable? How do we answer the questions of meaning and purpose? And how do we do it if everything that ever is or was or will be is just star stuff? Where do we derive hope? If that's true, William Provine, he's now gone. He's a professor at Cornell, and he's a committed atheist naturalist. He was very candid when he said this: no gods, no life after death, no ultimate foundation for ethics, no ultimate meaning in life, no human free will are deeply connected to the evolutionary perspective. He's not the only one. Richard Dawkins. We all know Richard. Well, I don't know him. I've read him. One thing about him, at least he's honest when he says this: in a universe of electrons and selfish genes, the blind physical forces and genetic replication, some people are going to get hurt. Listen to this. Some people are going to get hurt. Other people, they're going to get lucky. And you won't find any rhyme or reason about it, nor any justice. The universe that we observe has precisely the properties we should expect if there is at bottom no design, no purpose, no evil, no good, nothing but pitiless indifference. You see, naturalism tells us that life is solitary, poor, brutish, and short. That's from Leviathan, Thomas Hobbes, a committed atheist. We're told that it's a dog-eat-dog world, friends. That's what they're going to tell us. It's a dog-eat-dog world, and we better get busy living, or we better get busy dying. And it doesn't matter which one you choose, because you can't derive meaning or purpose to that life. And then the search for hope, friends, the search for hope, it finds its end ultimately in ourselves, our human effort, pulling ourselves up by our own bootstraps, searching for hope and more education and power and fame and money and sex. This is where we're turning to. But what happens when we fail, friends? What happens when we fail? We got to go back to more education, more power, more money, more sex. But what happens when we fail? More power, more education. It's just a cycle, and it continues forever, and you get exhausted. And we've seen this played out so many times in our generation. Friends, you see the faces on the screen. We've got David Carradine, Robin Williams, Anthony Bourdain. You've got Kurt Cobain, Junior Seau, Dave Mirra, Avicii, Heath Ledger, Chris Cornell, and up in the corner over there, whatever side that is for you guys. That's Kelly Catlin, 18 years old, an Olympic gold medalist, reached the pinnacle of her career, and then she killed herself. People reaching what's supposed to give them the most satisfaction. And when they get there, when they get to that mountaintop, what's there? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. See, naturalism, friends, naturalism, in the end, it just simply can't deliver on the promises it makes. And at its bottom is a materialistic, narcissistic view of reality that leaves its proponents completely empty. And it's out of that emptiness that they believe the lie that they're better off dead than alive. Friends, I know these things because I'm a man that's I'm not only a pastor and a speaker with standard reason, but I'm a man who's been changed dramatically by the grace of God. I've experienced this grace because I used to be a naturalist just, 13 years ago. I tried to push the boundaries of naturalism. I tried to live consistently with my worldview and before Christ introduced himself to me. And I'll tell you what, as I tried to live consistently with that worldview, things got very dark very quick. If we want to be continue being honest with you tonight, friends. When I got word of Ronzo, my friend from high school who killed himself, as I was walking down the streets of D.C., I remember my sister calling me, Ronzo hung himself in his closet. My response was anger. How selfish. You notice when I say that, it's me-centered? No pity. Not even real pain. Selfishness. But I was being consistent with my worldview. That's where I was. I was without hope, friends. But there is a hope. And it's a hope that's available to all people. It's a hope that's found outside of ourselves and in the person and work of Jesus Christ. It has nothing to do with us and everything to do with Jesus. I just didn't know that yet. We live in a fallen world, and that is the reality. That is the truth. And because we live in that fallen world, friends, it's not just the non-Christian who wrestles with suicide. You know, just because we're a Christian doesn't mean we're not susceptible to the lies of the world around us. I love Paul. I'm told that this is a Bible-preaching church. Let's preach some Bible. Paul says this. He says, be careful how you walk. Listen. Be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, because the days are evil. We need to live circumspectly, friends. That's what Paul's getting at. We need to be cautious. We need to be vigilant. Paul says that we need to always be on alert. Why? Because our adversary, the devil, is prowling around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. These are the truths of reality. Christian, you might be struggling with this issue personally, or maybe you have a friend who's struggling with it, but you're not alone. I want to encourage us to always have our eyes wide open in order to confront the reality that we too struggle in this life, even to the point of wanting to give up and die. We've seen it here in Southern California in a very, very real way, right here in your neck of the woods. Two pastors, Jared Wilson, associate pastor at Harvest Christian Fellowship, right down the road, right? Died by suicide. He's in the green jacket. And Andrew Stockline of Inland Hills Church in Chino. Young men who loved Jesus. Believed the lie that they were better off dead than alive. You know, some of us in this room, we have friends who have attempted suicide. Some of us in this room ourselves have attempted suicide. We're not exempt. Life is hard. Do you guys know this? Life is stinking hard. Especially right now. Life is hard. I got four girls. There's somebody always crying in my house, and it's usually me. Curled up in the fetal position over in the corner, friends. Life is hard. Wait till they're teenagers, is what I'm told. I'm out of here. Yeah. Four weddings. Friends, naturalism, okay, so naturalism at its core, we just saw at its core, it's hopeless. It's not able to prescribe ultimate meaning and purpose to anybody's life. But the Christian worldview, our worldview, presumably, if we're all Christians sitting in this room, if you're a Christian watching online, presumably, our worldview, its central message is one of meaning, purpose, and hope. So now what causes a believer in Christ to lose hope? What causes that person to believe this lie? I think it has something to do with one of the two things, maybe both of them, on your screen. The first is that life just becomes overwhelming due to loss and trials. You don't see a way out. The second is to do with legalism. We're going to hit one up at a time. Now, it's my heart right now, my desire. As we turn our attention to understanding why the believer contemplates suicide, I want to share with you the realities of the world we live in and how we respond as Christ's ambassadors when the days are particularly evil. Because the days are evil. So in God's word, we clearly see 7 examples of people committing suicide. There are 6 in the Old Testament, there's 1 in the New Testament. Who's the 1 in the New Testament? This is the participatory part of the program. Awesome, guys, yes. I'm just checking to make sure you're awake. Yeah, Judas. We'll get to him in a second. In the Old Testament, there's 5 examples of men who, when their lives were characterized by great heartache, guilt, loss, and struggle, they each had some baggage and pain they were carrying around, so much so that they were hopeless and they took their own lives. You know, when I think about Judas, the true tragedy of Judas's life isn't for me that he hung himself on that tree. It's that he betrayed his rabbi, he betrayed his best friend, but all he had to do was go back to Jesus and say, "I'm sorry." And Jesus would have forgiven him on the spot. And that just breaks my heart, that he would be overwhelmed by the guilt and the shame of what he had just done, that he saw no other way out than to throw a rope over a branch, wrap it around his neck, and jump, when all he needed to do was say, "I'm sorry," to his master. It breaks my heart. So these are the examples of people in the Bible who lost hope and they took their own lives due to overwhelming burdens, guilt, loss, and trials. But there's some examples of people who suffered incredible loss. I mean, incredible loss and trials, so great that they too wanted to die, but they chose not to. So can we go through those now? Yeah? Let's go through those. Let's see who these people are. First, we have Solomon. We have Solomon. We all know who Solomon was, right? He's the son of David and Bathsheba. He's the great king of Israel. He was blessed with wisdom, power, and money. He had so much promise, but he wasted so much of his life on sin and pleasure. You know, so much that as he became older and he authored that book that starts with the words "vanity of vanities," all is vanity. He's saying in Ecclesiastes that everything is meaningless. He would say in 2:17 that "I hate life, for the work which had been done under the sun was grievous to me. Everything is futile and striving after the winds." This is God's chosen king, friends. This is God's chosen king who said these things. He's saying that life is meaningless. Even the things I'm pursuing, it's like chasing after the wind. I can never catch it. There's no meaning. There's no purpose. There's no rhyme. There's no reason to why I'm doing this thing. He's saying I hate life. But it wasn't just Solomon, though. It wasn't just Solomon. And this is one of my favorite characters. Oh, no. No, close your eyes. Guys, do you guys remember who Elijah was? That Old Testament prophet, pastor, right? He's up on Mount Carmel. He's up on Mount Carmel. He's taking on the prophets of Baal. He's up there, and the children of Israel are all around them, intertwining themselves with these worshipers of false gods, and they're singing and they're dancing and they're cutting themselves and they're trying to worship these gods. But did they answer them back? Why? Because as they danced and cut themselves, as they called out, their passion, no matter how much passion, didn't make their gods real, and false gods never answer back. They always remain silent. Friends, idols always break the hearts of their worshipers. This is when Elijah, Elijah sees what's going on there, thousands and thousands of people worshiping these false gods, and he goes up to their altars, and he rains fire down from the sky to consume them. Do you remember what happens in the next chapter? Sometimes we forget this. 19, 1 Kings 19, Elijah is found running from the queen, this prophet of God who just called fire down from the sky. He just destroyed these false idols, right? He's seen running from the queen, hiding. It says this, that he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree. I have no idea what a juniper tree is, but he sat there. And he, Elijah, he requested for himself that he might die. This is one of the most powerful prophets who ever lived, the most powerful prophets of the true and living God, who just one chapter after experiencing such an amazing victory says these words, it's enough now, O Lord, take my life, is what he says. So he prayed that he'd die. Overwhelming challenges. Couldn't get himself outside of the moment. He wanted to end it. What about Jonah? We all love Jonah, hopefully not just from VeggieTale fame, but I think we remember Jonah, right? Why he's called by God to go to Nineveh to preach and lead a revival, and he immediately ran in the opposite direction, only to end up in the belly of a big fish before being vomited up onto the shores of that city. Do we remember this story? He's finding himself far away. He's far away from home against his will. He's in a place he hated. He's among people he despised, and he's asked to do something he didn't want to do. Listen to what Jonah says. Jonah wanted to die, and he said, it'd be better for me to die than to live. Does that sound familiar? Believing that same old lie. Jonah found himself believing a lie and without hope. He wanted desperately to get out of the circumstances in which he found himself. So desperate, he's willing to die to escape them. But it's not just the saints of the Old Testament. Don't think this is an Old Testament problem. New Testament, too. Let's look at Paul. A fearless apostle. He went on so many missionary journeys. Wrote a large portion of the New Testament. But in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, Paul says, For we do not want you to be unaware, brethren, of the affliction that came to us in Asia, that we were burdened excessively beyond our strength, so that we despised even of life. You see Paul do the trials and experiencing loss, expressing his desire for it all just to end. So friends, here we have four examples of believers, followers of God who, when life's circumstances simply got to be too much, when they were faced with losses and trials, they wanted to die. But you know why? I just want to know what the great testimony of their life is. The great testimony of their life is they said no, and they pressed on. Friends, that aging King Solomon, he pressed on. Elijah the prophet, he pressed on. Jonah, he pressed on. Paul, he pressed on. And through the darkness of their life, like, they saw the glory of the gospel resound and shine into everything. I mean, just look at what they did. You know, Elijah, he went on to pass the baton to Elijah, who did so many incredible things. Jonah, too, after finding himself in that place he didn't want to be with people he hated, he asked God to take his life. And what happened? What happened? He preached to Nineveh, and he led a revival. And the Bible tells us that every soul was saved. Whew. It's unbelievable. What about the Apostle Paul? Yeah, he despaired even of life, but if we continue to read his words, he says this. He says, indeed, we felt we have received the sentence of death, but this happens. Listen to these words. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead, friends. Our God does that. He raises the dead. Paul and his companions finding hope in the midst of their circumstances by leaning in on God and his promises. You know, Paul tells us so often, right? I love this. For momentary light afflictions are producing in us eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. Far beyond all comparison. Notice there's two things going on here in this verse. The first is, yes, these things are momentary light afflictions, okay? But that's not comforting to me when I'm in the middle of something. This too shall pass. But notice he's pointing us beyond our circumstances and he's pointing us to an eternal timeline where the truth is this too shall pass. But he's also doing something else. Paul's reminding us that, the moments that we find ourselves in are temporary. But those afflictions, they're creating in something in us that otherwise wouldn't be there. You see, these afflictions, these pains, these trials, these discomforts, they're not there for naught. God is not punishing us through them, friends. Maybe he's growing us. Maybe he's preparing us, is what Paul's saying here. And ultimately, he's using our afflictions to prepare us for glory, for heaven. You know, Paul's going to go on, and I love this verse too. He's going to go on and write, I press on toward the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus, pointing us through our trials, through our circumstances, through our loss, and to Jesus Christ and the hope of his cross, friends. That's where Paul's pointing us to that old rugged cross on Calvary. Let me say, friends, if you're here and you find yourself heavy laden with sin, and in many sins maybe, maybe you're being crushed under the weight of your sins. Press on. If you find yourselves here this evening or online right now watching us, if you find yourselves here this evening and you are in despair because of the circumstances you find yourself in, press on, please. Press on because there is hope. I promise you, when you press on, hope will be restored. I promise you that, Christian. That is the truth. Press on. But there's another reason, and I got to start going really fast. It's the idea that our relationship with God is ultimately dependent on a system of do's and don'ts, and this is legalism. You know, so what we do is we take this system of do's and don'ts and we place it on top of the grace of God. You know, oftentimes it's demonstrated by the Christian who's constantly measuring themselves up to something, or maybe he's measuring himself up or herself up to somebody else. Maybe he's measuring himself or herself up to the standard of the law. But friends, let me tell you right now that you never measure up. That's the point of the gospel. That's the point of the cross. We can't ever measure up. The law is a teacher. It points us to our need for a Savior. We need to understand this, friends. We need to understand that we never measure up, and that's okay. It has very little to do with our performance. It has everything to do with the grace of God found in Christ Jesus. You know, the Apostle John says, for the law was given through Moses, grace and truth come through Jesus Christ. The psalmist, oh, I love these words. Out of the depths I've cried to you, hear my voice. If you, Lord, should mark iniquities, oh Lord, who could stand? There is forgiveness with you, is what the psalmist says. Here we see the mercy of God is found in the forgiveness of sins. God doesn't keep a record of right and wrong. If he did, nobody could stand. Not one of us would pass judgment by a holy and a just God apart from the grace of God. We can't live up to his standards. There's not one person, friends, who can live up to the standard of the law. And when we lean towards legalism, we exhaust ourselves. We exhaust ourselves into hopelessness. And it's then we start to believe that lie, you're better off dead than alive. You never measure up. You might as well just end it. And it's a lie. It's a lie from Satan. He's lying to you if that's what you're thinking, friends. He's lying to you right now. We have to remind each other, yes, we all fall short of the glory of God. But equally true are these words by Paul. King David. He's not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his loving kindness towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Friends, if God were to mark our iniquities, not one of us could stand. It's not about living by a set of rules. God's love for his children, for you and for me. Did you guys, Christian, do you know that you're God's child? Did you know that you were adopted into the kingdom of God? Oh, there's so much to say. What's God's? Just say it. I'm sorry? Everything. Yes, A plus. Everything. And the scriptures tell us that everything that is God's will be ours. That means what's going to be ours? Everything. Everything. We're fellow heirs with Jesus Christ, my brothers and sisters. Do not confuse the moment with the story. Do not allow your current circumstances to weigh you down. Do not allow the devil to be whispering that you don't measure up. You don't have to. Jesus died for you, friends. I'm so far off my notes, it's not even funny. I'm glad you love me. Friends, it's out of legalism. It comes the question that I get the most. I guarantee you it's already in the feed or whatever it is, the app. Can a Christian commit suicide and still go to heaven? And this question breaks my heart. There's this idea that if a Christian finds himself in such disarray and believing the lie and so stressed out and just wanting to end it all that he takes his own life, that somehow he doesn't end up in heaven. And let me just be clear right now. It's this idea that because he wasn't able to repent of that sin, he's somehow no longer eligible for the grace of God, which was promised to him through Jesus Christ. For friends, according to the Bible, the manner in which a person dies has no determination as to whether a person goes to heaven or hell. Let me ask you this, just let's make it clear, because I know some of you aren't loving me right now. If an unbeliever takes his own life by suicide, does he go to heaven or hell? Which one? Why? Did it have to do with his suicide? If a believer who trusts Jesus for his salvation dies by suicide, it's not the suicide that determines whether he goes to heaven or hell, friends. It's what he does with Jesus. God is not going to ask you how you died when you stand before him. He's going to say, "What did you do with my son?" That's all that matters. We need to get rid of this lie. Yes, friends, and this is another question I get. Suicide's a serious sin. It's self-murder. It's suicide. It's never the answer. We never pursue sin as Christians intentionally. Paul addresses this all over Romans. Should we go on sinning so that grace may abound? Absolutely not. Paul says, may it never be. Suicide's a sin, but it doesn't determine your eternal destiny. It doesn't. Friends, I want to be convinced of these words just as Paul was. Neither life nor death, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Believer, brother, sister, there is nothing that can separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing. Nothing. Don't believe the lies. I'm not preaching a cheap grace either. We can get to that in Q&A if you'd like. Oh, man, it's in these things that we're talking about tonight that this undying hope that we all need is found. So we've seen why people might contemplate suicide from the non-believer side and then the believer side. Let's spend my last maybe 3 minutes here. I'm going over. I'm really sorry. I really am sorry. I told you it would happen. We're used to it. that man just lost his salvation. Yeah, you just lost a crown, buddy. Friends, just because you're a Christian doesn't mean we're exempt from that struggle. That's life. The presence of trials and loss, it sometimes results in at least momentary losing hope. It does. That's the truth of the matter. But as we press on through those things, hope is eventually restored. I love Jesus' words in John. He says, in the world you have tribulation, but take courage. Why? Yeah. I have overcome the world. And friends, legalism, it crushes that hope. As we try to live according to a standard that we're not supposed to live to. Now let's talk about the what question. Okay. What can we do? Let's get practical. What can I do to help? Well, first thing is to remember that you're not alone. There's a lot of people who can not only help if you're struggling like this, there's not only a lot of people who can help, but there's a lot of people who understand exactly where you are. And not only that, but because they were where you are, they want to help you so bad. So my first piece of advice, friends, is the most difficult thing to do, but it's simple. Talk to somebody. Talk to somebody. I know that's so hard to do. I really do. I know it's so hard, but you got to. It's too important not to. It's too important. Believer, non-believer, it doesn't matter. Reach out. Find a teacher, a coworker, a parent, a loved one, a husband, a wife, a pastor, anybody, and talk to them about it. Let them know. You know, one of the lies that we face as Christians is that life isn't going to be as hard as it is. I mean, I remember when I became a Christian, I thought, oh boy, everything's going to get really good now. Uh-uh. Life for me got a lot more difficult. I mean, it got really good, but it got more difficult. You know, but that's why the promises that we hear from God are so important. My grace is sufficient for you, for the power is perfected in weakness. That's what God tells us, you know? And Paul says, I'd rather boast in weakness. Why? Why would you rather boast in weakness? So that the power of Christ may dwell in me. For I am, when I'm weak, I am strong, is what he goes on to say. It's okay to talk to one another about our struggles. They will know you are my disciples by how you love one another. Confess your sins to one another. Does anybody know why? So that you will be healed, Pastor. That's why we do it. We live in community together. That's what separates us from the world. That's what Francis Schaeffer calls the mark of the Christian. I tried my best with that word. The mark of the Christian. It was like a hybrid there. What was I thinking? But part of that also means that we need to be available to one another, friends. You know, on that same note, if you have a friend, hear me here, if you have a friend a coworker, a spouse, a loved one who's confided in you, or you may think that they're thinking about harming themselves, what do you do? If they've confided in you, the first thing is never make a promise that you can't keep. Never tell them, I promise I won't tell anyone. Because sometimes you have to, especially if you're watching, you're a student. I see some young folks in the back. If somebody talks to you about this issue, you gotta get help. You go to a parent, you go to a trusted loved one, you go to a teacher, a guidance counselor. You gotta talk to somebody. You need to. And just believe me, because I've seen it happen that the person is gonna ultimately thank you for your faithfulness, as you have to put your friendship maybe on hold in order for their health, for their life. And this leads to another question: how can I tell if somebody's about to or maybe contemplating suicide? I just have four things up there, mainly because the screen is, well, this screen's huge, but it just doesn't hold a ton. If you see somebody that's persistently sad, crying for no real apparent reason, unless they're a 10 or an 8-year-old girl, you know, if somebody's starting to miss a lot of work and a lot of school where otherwise they were faithful, if they've experienced or expressing that they've experienced hopelessness, if they're coming to you and they're saying they're worthless, if they're saying, I just want to end it all, these are some of the signs, friends. And what do you do if somebody's saying these things? And it's a combination of things. It's not just one of them, but what do? You have to ask this question. It's not complicated, friends. It's just really hard. Have you thought about suicide? For the longest time, it used to be that the advice was, don't use that word. You don't want to plant any thoughts in their mind, but that won't happen. They're already thinking about it. And if they're not, they'll go, whoa, no, I would never do that. Secondly, if they confess or if they say, yes, I've been thinking about that, or if somebody comes to you and says they've been thinking about that, it needs to be taken seriously. There are no idle threats anymore, friends. 25% of 18 to 24-year-olds, 25% have contemplated suicide in the last 6 months. There's no more idle threats. Everyone needs to be taken seriously and get help. And you'll notice that there's a number for help up there. If you want to jot that down, you can do that. You know, there's also, I'm told, tonight right here on site, there's counselors that want to talk with you and help you. There's pastors here that want to pray with you and love on you. If this is you, you need to get help, and it needs to be tonight. Not tomorrow morning when you feel better. It needs to be tonight. Another way that you can get involved is through Stand to Reason, right? I put out resources on this stuff. I have these cards here with me tonight that if they're out somewhere, and if you fill one out and get it back to me, I'll send you this presentation and all my notes on this topic, along with two or three blog articles that I've written on it, just to get you resources. You're just going to grab one of these, fill it out, and hand the portion back to me. I want to be there for you and help. Friends, what the world wants us to place our hope in is meaningless. That steady, unchanging relationship with the God of the universe, that's the only thing that really ultimately matters. So many times, friends, so many times the world's going to want us place our hope in something different. Want to judge ourselves by how many likes a post gets or how many friends we have on Facebook, for crying out loud. We place so much value and worth in that. How are my Instagram accounts doing? What? Check Insta. That's where we derive our purpose. We find our purpose and meaning in girlfriends and boyfriends, husbands, wives, jobs, money, none of that. It's all fleeting, friends. You'll all come up empty. So as I finish up, just let me remind you of who you are, Christian. Let me remind you that you were made in the image of God. He
He knit you together in your mother's womb. He calls you by name. He's numbered the hairs on your, not for me and you, but everybody else. He's numbered the hairs on your head. He goes with you whether you lay down or stand up, whether you go up to the heights of heaven or down the Sheol. He's always with you. You cannot escape his presence. And he calls you loved one. He calls you son. He calls you daughter. And his love for you is consistent. And you'll never stand before him more righteous than you do right now. Did you know that, Christian? There is nothing that can separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate you from that. This is who you are. And when we place our identity in the fact that God loves us without explanation, there's no escaping the fact that we have value of infinite worth. We're meaningful. We're purposeful. Even when we find ourselves in circumstances that are going to tell us not to place any worth in this life. Press on, my friends. Jesus loves you so much that he went to the cross for you. At the beginning of our time together, we started with these words by William Cowper, encompassed with 1,000 dangers, weary, faint, trembling with 1,000 terrors, I in a fleshly tomb and buried above ground. Friends, the same man who wrestled just as so many of us Russell had a friend in John Newton. He was encouraged to press on through his trials. He was encouraged to press on through his losses. And he was reminded of the grace of God found in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he pressed on to pen these words. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilt and stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day, and there have I, though vile as he, washed all my sins away. Dear dying lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power, till on that ransomed church of God are safe to sin no more. Ere since by faith I saw the stream thy flowing wounds supply, redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. When this poor lispering, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave, then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to save. Press on, brothers and sisters. Press on. Thank you.
All right. Why don't you, everybody just stand for a moment. Just stretch a little bit. We have some questions that have been asked of us, and I would like to try to get you out of here by 8:30. So we have about 22 minutes to deal with questions. So we're going to do a quick changeover. Just stretch a little bit. And we're gonna deal with those questions. So when you're ready, sit back down, and we'll start taking questions. That? Who said we're used to it? Was it over here? Praise the Lord. That's good. Hey, John, one thing that when you mentioned legalism, I was thinking about the suicide rate in non-Christian cults and how I've heard that people who are involved in legalistic cultic movements, there's a really, really high rate of suicide that doesn't get a whole lot of talk.
Yeah.
And so that just made me think of that. But
I was actually, an interesting note is I was actually just up in Bountiful, Utah, which I just love that name. But it's heavily Christian cult is there. And suicide is the number one cause of death for those aged 13 to 28.
And we'll just put it out there. It is Mormon.
It
country.
Is Mormon. I didn't know where you were trying.
No,
yeah.
It's okay. But no, I think we're saying it
it's
in
Mormon
love.
Country.
It's not. Yeah. It's not that we're trying to bag on anybody. We're just saying it in love. That if someone is We actually broadcast Walk in Truth in Utah.
Oh, praise the Lord.
And we're told that we have a lot of Mormon listeners who secretly listen to Christian radio.
Yeah, good.
And hopefully, prayerfully, and maybe it's you tonight, or maybe you're going to watch this later. If that's you, the gospel says that your sin has been paid for in full. And I love the emphasis that you put there. But I think it's just, it's something that's just reality for people who are trying to earn their salvation. It's just, man, it can be a heavy burden. Okay, Mike.
Yes.
You have questions for us.
I do.
Okay.
I don't know where they are, but I do have questions. Somewhere there.
up on the screen.
First one was who was the Lego guy in the presentation?
That's Zimri.
Okay.
And a gold star. If anybody can tell me who Zimri was. Yeah, not a person.
It's just a link. Yeah. Okay. All right.
Go on.
All right, first real question. Does a pastor or priest have the authority to approve assisted suicide, and should this ever be encouraged?
Are you looking at me? Well, I would say from let's go back to a worldview standpoint. So when you are pro-life, you believe that life begins at conception and ends at natural death. So let me say that one more time. If you're pro-life, truly pro-life, you believe life begins at conception and ends at natural death. So inherent in that word natural is that life and death is God's business, not mine. Now, I do want to say that if someone that we love is suffering, and sometimes people make the argument that, well, you know, you'll be compassionate to your pet and take them out of their misery, kind of thing. So why wouldn't you do the same for people? But people are the only ones that I know of that are made in the image of God. And life and death are in his hands. All the days, I think you referenced Psalm 139, all the days of my life are written in his book before one of them came to pass. And so I would just argue from the sovereignty of God, even if we suffer, and none of us want to suffer, and some of you have watched loved ones die, and it can be a very difficult situation, but even you mentioned the momentary light affliction or our suffering, here God often uses that, and I don't understand everything, but even the thorn in the flesh that Paul talked about, he talked about even rejoicing in that, because... when he's weak, then he's strong. Again, there are many question marks around this, but I'll just say this. No pastor or priest has the authority to approve assisted suicide, because we would be approving essentially a murder. And so what we would say is that we want to be by someone's side praying for them, but we can't make that call. Now, I will say that if someone has a DNR, and they are on life-sustaining equipment, and they've decided that if they die naturally, that's their choice. And I know a lot of people have done a DNR, and they have their wishes there expressed to the family. Then that's a little different. That is a different situation.
Yeah.
And so that's where we would bring a little bit more light to that, and say someone has a DNR, they don't want to be artificially kept alive.
That's a big difference, right?
Yeah,
so there's nobody that's actively pursuing the killing of that individual in a DNR situation. Yeah, this is probably one of the more difficult issues that we are wrestling with as far as ethics goes today. Two things. I'm complete agreement with you, absolutely, Pastor. I mean, we serve a huge God, friends, and I feel like sometimes we lose sight of the fact that we live in also a supernatural world, where miracles happen every day. Every day. And we don't want to necessarily believe that. But just because we wrestle with that doesn't mean we have the authority to do God's work for him. We continue to believe on God, and we believe his promises that he has on our lives and also the ones that we're struggling with, right? So I've read these verses, right? So their momentary light afflictions produce in us eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison. Or Paul also says that our struggles produce in us, right, steadfastness, character, proven character, right, and other things, and that's true because if the here and now is not all we have, we have to make sure we don't put on a naturalistic perspective.
The majority of the time that you guys experience is outside of this world. It's in a new world, a new heaven and a new earth. And then also, I'm not that big.
You're okay.
I should get back on that Peloton. No, there's a, I don't know if you guys know Annie Johnson Flint, and she's a poet, hymn writer, who's now gone, and she suffered incredibly. Look her up when you get home. But she wrote this in the middle of her suffering. I mean, she was incontinent. She was covered in sores. She had to be surrounded by pillows because of the pain and anguish that she was in. And she wrote these words, "He giveth more grace when the burdens go greater. He sendeth more strength when the labors increase. To add an affliction, he addeth his mercy. To multiply trials, he multiplied peace. When we have exhausted," oh, this is so good. "When we have exhausted our store of endurance, when our strength has failed ere the day is half done, when we reach the end of our hoarded resources, our Father's forgiven is only begun. His love has no limit, his grace has no measure, his power no boundary known unto men. For out of his infinite riches in Jesus, he giveth and giveth and giveth again." No matter the circumstances that we find ourselves and our loved ones in, it's important to remember that God is full of grace. And even in the midst of suffering, God can grant us grace that we might not completely understand. And we go in with an eternal perspective as well. We understand that the suffering here is momentary. That's a fact. And I think that we've all experienced stuff like that. So that's a hard question. That's a good one.
All right.
Easy one this time.
Okay. How can I comfort and encourage someone I know whose child has committed suicide? How do you go to a parent and comfort them?
Yeah. So I'm a direct guy. If you didn't notice from my speaking, like I lay it all out there. I just go to them. Just let them know your heart. I'm so sorry. And they've heard it 1,000 times. But it's meaningful. Send cards. Don't avoid the topic. Don't avoid the topic. That's one of the things like the church is so good at on Sunday morning. I'll be in a massive fight with my wife. Like my car will be blowing up. The kids are screaming at each other. And I get out all of a sudden. "How's it going, Pastor John?" "Oh, fantastic. Blessed." You know, it's like, no, I'm miserable right now. I messed up with my wife. She's mad at me. My kids are awful. Like, no, I just want to be real with somebody. So that extends to the same thing with your friends who are suffering great loss and trials. They will know you are my disciples by how you love one another.
One thing I would say, too, is that we do have some families that I am aware of that have walked through this and have lost someone to suicide. And so I was thinking of 2 Corinthians 1, where it says that we can, that God comforts us in all of our afflictions so that we can comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. So if you're aware of someone who maybe as a family walked through this and you know, for some, they would say it's become at least a part of their ministry to minister to others who are broken, I would just say that maybe you ministering to them, as you just mentioned, Pastor, but also saying, hey, there are some people that I'm aware of that you could talk to who have been through this, and they can comfort you. Because I do think that there is a power in having been through something. And, of course, none of us would want to go through that. But, you know, one of the things that comes to mind is Greg Laurie and what he went through with the loss of his son and how much ministry has come out of sometimes losses like this. So I think both those things could be helpful. And just saying, hey, I'm here for you. And, you know, if you need an ear, if you need a shoulder, I'm here to pray for you. And, yeah.
All right, next. Okay, what are the signs to look for in children, adolescents, and adults who are depressed or maybe suicidal? So I'm guessing it might be different for the three different age groups, or are there common themes? Or
yeah, it's actually pretty common across age groups. Kids are actually a little bit more, they wear their emotions on their sleeves, right? So you can kind of tell with kids a little bit better than adults. Adults will throw themselves into their life, into their work or whatnot, and find distraction. Where kids generally are pretty, they lay it kind of out there, especially with their friends. You know, so one of my goals in life, and we'll see how we do, you can talk to me in 15 years and see how this went, is to be
I want to be that parent that all my kids' friends want to be around. You know, so then I'm hearing the talk and the chatter and able to discern what's going on, not just in my kids' lives, but also in the lives of their friends, you know, as I seek to disciple them. But the signs were, I mean, I only put four up there, but there's so many. And afterwards, if you guys have questions, there's a website that was in my presentation, I left it down there, that you can go to and check off or look up the signs to look at them. But if somebody who's normally pretty laid back all of a sudden is becoming very anxious, if they were once not active sexually and all of a sudden they become promiscuous, any major changes in behavior that is pretty radical, if they start missing work or school, if their studies fail or drop off, if sleep patterns change radically, or they start looking disheveled in their appearance where once, you know, they looked, I mean, some people just look disheveled, you know. That's usually me, so I can say that from experience. But, you know, but these are the things that you look for, any types of changes in behavior, and of course, expressions of hopelessness, despair, worthlessness. And then you just ask the question, you know, have you thought about committing suicide? Have you thought about suicide? It's not, have you thought about harming yourself? Oh, that's another one, self-harm. That is huge right now with kids. The cutting and burning and other forms of self-harm. And that often gets progressively worse and can result.
One thing I was going to mention, too, is that you guys know that we have pastors who are licensed counselors, and we have others in our sphere of ministry that are licensed and have degrees in counseling that are part of our team to minister to people. So if something is, so to speak, above your pay grade and you're like, I don't know what to do with this, if you come to one of us and just say, hey, I know someone who's in trouble, we can refer out to people who have a background in education in this. So that's something important to know. There was a part B. What part does drugs and mental illness play in suicide?
Yeah. There's lots of issues. One of the struggles with suicide as a topic is, well, once somebody dies by suicide, I'm not being flippant, you can't ask them why and what was the cause. And drugs, they play a role for sure. You know, mental illness plays a role, but the data is telling us that it's something more that's going on. It's and I firmly believe I firmly believe that it's spiritual, a lot of it. And I'm not shunning mental health. If I'm just going to be clear, like if you are depressed, please see a doctor and get on meds. I've seen them work really, really well for people. You know, I'm not saying that it's all demonic activity, but we live in a world that's believing a ton of different lies, and people are placing their value and worth in things that they ought not. And we need to keep that in mind. So how do drugs and alcohol and mental illness play? As of right now, the slight majority of people who die by suicide have never been, 54% have never been diagnosed with a mental illness. I'm not saying that they're not mentally ill at all, but they haven't been diagnosed, so we got to go where the data goes. As far as drug abuse, it's hard to tell. That's one of the issues with this topic. Is you read, it's funny, you read these scientific papers and all this literature, I've read these books, and the author goes on pages and pages and pages of why people commit suicide, but then at the end of the chapter, but we really don't know. You know, we used to think it was suicide notes, but now we're finding out that notes actually are very unreliable as to why people are doing or committing suicide. You know, not always truthful in the notes.
You mentioned that you're very direct when you approach somebody about their feelings. One of the questions we had from someone was, if you know somebody in your family is struggling with dark thoughts, what are some of the questions you ask? Maybe they're not as direct as you are, but is there any other questions they could ask to maybe draw that out of them?
Yeah, it's going to be if you at all think that your loved one is going to die by suicide or harm themselves at all, you just ask the question. And it may seem like it's out of left field, but it doesn't have to be. Hey, you know, Billy, you know, I've just noticed X, Y, and Z, and your behavior's changed in the last 3 months. And, you know, I just actually went to a church. I just heard this talk on suicide. Have you ever thought about dying by suicide? Is that ever on your mind? You know, no, I'm just wondering. And you'll be surprised how people react. Studies are showing right now that when you use that verbiage, when you say, have you thought about suicide, rates are drastically declining with those people because now it's out there. And like I said at the very beginning of the talk, when we shine light on sin, there's healing. And when we start talking about these things directly, we see a major effect. That's one of the number one preventers of suicide, is asking that direct question. So that's what I'd say. It doesn't have to be like, yo, are you going to kill yourself? Like, don't say that, you know, but go to them and say, hey, I care for you. I love you. Recently, I just heard this talk, or recently I've been thinking about this issue. Some of your behavior is kind of concerning to me. Maybe you might want to talk about it, but have you ever thought about dying?
One thing to think about is when things are brought into the light, they lose their power.
That's right.
And so when something is in a dark corner, it can be much more powerful. When it's brought into the light, it loses power. And when Christ's light shines on it, it of course is going to lose power. And so that's where we say, hey, we try to bring it into the light. We do it tactfully. We do it with compassion. But that's where I think people will find hope. And especially understanding, as you said, that they're not alone, that a lot of people are struggling with stuff like this. Next one.
All right, next one. This one's rough. This person said they know a 10-year-old who witnessed the passing of two infant siblings who had health problems. On top of that, he's bullied, or he or she, I'm not sure, and that they're actually told by a bully that they should kill themselves. And how do you help a kid like that?
Dude, that's heartbreaking. I'm so sorry to whoever answered this question. I mean, asked this question. Oh, man. I just want to pray for you. But I would say, similar to what you just said, you are currently right now, if this is a real situation and you're in this room, you're at a church that has resources for you. This is so far above my pay grade that I would say that you got to get some help through a professional person. Bullying is no joke, and it needs to stop. So if this is your son or daughter that's being bullied, it needs to stop, and like now. So we need to help you take steps in how to get that to stop.
Pastor, part of what I think...
That's a hard one, man.
When you talk about the body and you talk about the community, so you mentioned something very important, which is that we have people who have this background professionally. But the other thing is that the body of Christ can encircle a family and try to love them through stuff like this. And once it's brought into the light, there are multiple, you could say, directions through which ministry can come to a person and a family. It's not just singular, right? There's all these gifts in the body of Christ and all these different strengths that we have that we can minister to a family. And sometimes it's hospitality, sometimes it's meals, sometimes it's prayer warriors who commit to pray for a family. It's a professional who has the background. It's a pastor who, you know, is a listening ear and praying with the family. There can be multiple ways to address stuff like this. So I would just say, please get help. Please talk to us and let us help at least get some of the early steps going.
Is it practical to say, as a parent, I'm just going to pull my kid out of that school? Are you taking your kid out of, you know, are you coddling your child, or is that something that you need to do as a parent to protect your child?
I don't know if it's coddling your child to get them away from somebody who's telling them he should kill himself. But my concern is if it's not your child, this bully is going to say the same thing if he hasn't already to a number of other people. So the problem isn't your child. The problem is this other child.
Right. But you can't pull them out of school.
Well, you can't, but you can certainly seek the advice of wise counsel of people. This is kind of the main thrust, if you guys caught it through the whole talk, is you're not alone. There are people in this room even right now, an audience this size, there's somebody right here who's gone through a very similar situation, maybe not exact details, but you can, like you said, community. Talk to people who have been through this. Experiences matter. You know, how did they solve it? You know, how did they, what route did they go? But I don't think, I mean, I think pulling your kid out of the school is one possible avoidance, but I think it's a Band-Aid.
Well, and the other thing is, you need to be on that administrator's doorstep.
Absolutely.
And making sure that they're aware of it. And that may be what you need to do is pull them out of there, but
maybe,
you know, let's talk to the school and let's see, you know, about them pulling that kid in, making sure that that's confronted so sure. He doesn't do it to other kids as well. This person is obviously very vulnerable, but the bully needs to be addressed. Yeah. And so I would just say that parent should go to the administration and whatever help they need, if someone needs to go with them, then let's do that so that is addressed.
I'd say, I think as a parent, you need to be on top of it. Like you said, go to the school. But if it persists, and it often does, you know, kids are going to be kids, then I think it's your responsibility to take care of your own. Last question. What if somebody is in this dark spot and they don't want to be helped? They don't want to listen to you. They don't want to hear your counsel.
Yeah, so this is another one I get almost every location, every time I've given this talk, this is a question I've gotten. If it's a student, you gotta find help for them. They don't have full control over where they sit and the audience that they maintain, right? You can get your kid or somebody else in a counseling situation, you can make your kid do it. It's not pleasant, it might be hard, but it'd be worth it. If it's an adult, this is one of the hardest things for me to say, but you can't force somebody to get help. I don't know if you guys have ever had any experience with people who are addicted to drugs, alcohol, whatever, and they don't want help. You can't force it. I mean, you can bring them into your house for a certain amount of time, but if they don't want the help, they're not going to get clean. It's the same thing with suicide. If somebody's, and I hate to say this, but if they're dead set on doing this, they're going to do it. Now, that doesn't mean we don't do anything, right? We do whatever we can. You know, be a thorn in that person. Stand the reason we have the saying, stone in their shoe, right? We put a stone in their shoe, something for somebody to think about. Well, be an annoyance, a nice annoyance for this person, letting them know, like, I'm here for you always. I know that you're going through this, and I just want to let you know, I'm here for you. I'm going to be here for you tomorrow. I'm going to be here for you, in 2 weeks. So you're making yourself available, but you can't force them, unfortunately. Sometimes, you know, with my friends and my cousin, I wish I could have, but you can't force somebody into help.
Mike, there's another one up there.
We got one more. Okay. It cuts off a little bit.
So it's basically someone who.
It's back there.
It's back here. Okay, let's see. How do we summarize this question? Okay, so I think what is being said there is the fear of God kept this person from committing suicide. Is that what you guys read there?
I barely.
Okay, anyway.
So the question is that they know someone who
God
has contemplated suicide, but the fear of doing that and then going to hell as a result has kept them from carrying that out.
Yeah.
And the conclusion of the question was, I almost am glad that they had that fear, and I don't know if that's right. So just some counsel for this person.
Yeah.
Historically speaking, the group of people who experience suicide the least are Catholic women. And it's a lot to do with guilt. The Catholic Church, if any of us have Catholic backgrounds, will teach you that suicide's a mortal sin. You commit suicide, you go to hell. And the fear of going to hell keeps many Catholic women in particular from actually following through with these thoughts. Now, two things. Just because someone doesn't follow through, the very fact that they're seriously considering this means they need some help. So it's important that we follow through on our relationship with them to get them the help that they need, even if they're not really going to do it because of guilt. Second, the guilt isn't maybe always going to be persistent. It may let up. I have a friend who just died by suicide, Mike Adams. And, Mike, he died, what, a month ago? He was somebody I looked up to, and I had him out to our church to speak a couple years back, and he was passionate that I get this talk up and running. I didn't know he struggled with thoughts of suicide, but I tend to think that maybe one of the things that stayed off his actually going through with it was a sense of guilt. You know, more related to not necessarily whether or not he had a right standing with God or how would this affect God, but more as a Christian witness. He was prolific in his ministry. Free speech advocate, UNC Wilmington professor. He sued Wilmington and went all the way to Supreme Court and won, and that's how he got his tenure. And he was a thorn in their side for 15 years, man, because he couldn't get fired. So he would say whatever was on his mind, and he was so good. Look him up, Mike Adams. Amazing work. But I think what happened is eventually, you know, these thoughts increased in him and his Christian witness, the guilt that was associated with possibly following through, started to subside more to, well, maybe this is going to solve my problems, and that lie becomes palpable.
And what I would add is that there's a healthy fear of God. There's a biblical fear of God that we need to talk about. And that's the good. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So I want to please God. I want to make sure I'm honoring my Father. There's multiple levels to the healthy fear of the Lord to keep us from making, you know, dumb or destructive decisions. But the idea of the Roman Catholic point of view, and, you know, a lot of former Roman Catholics joke that they attended Our Lady of Perpetual Guilt. That was their home church.
And, man.
Yeah. Anyway, but I would just say this, that a healthy fear of the Lord can be a good thing.
Absolutely. Well, so, and I kind of flew through this section a little bit more because I saw time was starting to, believe it or not, I didn't say everything I had to say. But Solomon, when you read the end of Ecclesiastes, right, vanity of vanities, all is vanity, and he goes through, it's like chasing after the wind, and the way he concludes here is fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. So what he's saying is that we have a healthy fear of the Lord, and we do what he says. And when we do that, we can be guaranteed not an easy life, not a happy life, but a good life, because it ends in the lap of God. With your Savior Jesus Christ, you know, and that's how he ends with that. You know, it's a healthy fear of the Lord that drives a lot of what we do. You know, I won't go on because I'll get myself in trouble.
But I love what you said too, and we're over our time. But I love the fact that you said there's more ahead of us than is behind us.
Oh, absolutely.
And when that hope is the anchor of our soul, you mentioned Romans 5, proven character,
yeah,
so hope, good. And that hope does not
That's right.
disappoint.
That's right.
Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who is given to us. Amen.
Praise
Thank
Lord.
You for being a patient group tonight. Would
Thank
you stand?
You.
So if you need help tonight, I mentioned, and Pastor John had mentioned, that there are people available, and that we will point you to them if you need counsel or help in any way. There's also people who are waiting to pray with you tonight. And so if you need prayer, you can come forward. You can talk to any of the pastors, and we will direct you towards where the person that you need to talk to. Please don't leave here tonight without being prayed for. Now, since we're over our time, I think we're just going to close in prayer right now and invite you that if you do need help, you would come forward and seek that help out from us. Again, let me emphasize, please don't leave here with something hanging that you need help with, okay? And especially if you've not met Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, let this be the night that you trust in him fully for your salvation and rest in his finished work, that your sins have been paid in full at the cross and through the resurrection. And you can know that hope, and you can have that the ultimate burden of sin and death lifted from you by trusting in the one who is our very life. Father, thank you for tonight. Thank you for Pastor John. Thank you for Mike Massaro. Thank you for all of those who made this night possible. We are grateful for the team of servants here. I pray for each and every precious soul that has joined us tonight or will watch this later. Please reach out to them with your everlasting love. You love people more than we can imagine. And I pray that each and every soul that has interacted with this content will find their hope in Jesus. So, Lord God, I just ask that you would minister your grace to your people and minister to those who don't know you. Draw them to yourself. And I thank you so much that we've had this night to spend together. Bless Pastor John and his family. Give them traveling mercies as they return home. Thank you for our 633 team and just everyone involved tonight. We love you, we worship you, and we pray in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Do you have something, Diane? Say it. Okay, I'm sorry. I wasn't sure what you were. There is a care group if you deal with anxiety and depression and stuff like that that meets here at Living Truth. And Dr. Diane Bull is ministering to that group. And if you would like to sign up, she will be in the foyer. Just wave, Diane, so everybody knows who you are. She'll be in the foyer. And if you want to talk to her, you can join that group and get some help that you need as well. God bless you all.
If you guys would like to stay in worship, you can. Please come forward for prayer. If you'd like to just get some prayer tonight, if there's things that are going on, please do that.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. Yes, I am a child of God. I'm no mother's womb, you have chosen me, and love has called my name. And I've been born again to your family, and your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. Oh, I am a child of God.